Hi, welcome to Cinefilm Recap. A man discovers glasses in a church that reveal the true face of aliens who are secretly controlling the Earthlings. Today we'll go over the plot of the film They Live. George Nada, a Colorado unemployed drifter, searches for sun across America. He arrives in Los Angeles with its huge skyscrapers and enormous chances. The man comes to a job center to find an official job. A lot of people, who are also looking for work, have gathered there. George has an interview and tells a job center worker about his difficult fate. A lot of businesses closed at the same time, leaving people without jobs. The woman doesn't pay much attention to George and says he doesn't have enough experience to get a job. He exits the job center with a sad smile. George stops to listen to a preacher while traversing the city. The preacher tells a small group of onlookers in an emotional way that demons have taken over the minds of the people who run the world and use them to control the rest of the people. The man tells the people listening to wake up and get away from the elites who are in charge. When Nada sees the police car, she decides to keep going. Along the way, he sees a strange man watching a meaningless ad on a TV behind a store window as if he were hypnotized. But Nada doesn't pay him much mind and keeps walking. George eventually finds a place for homeless people to stay for the night and plans to do so. A woman in the house next door is mesmerized by a TV show about a narcissistic star who thinks they will never get old. George is exhausted, so he leans back on his chair and breathes hard while thinking deeply. The next day, George visits a building site and applies for a laborer position there. The foreman initially rejects Nada since they only hire trade union members. George convinces the foreman to negotiate a pay and hire him. He starts sweating like everyone else. Even though the problem with his job has been fixed, he won't be able to get the money for a few days, so he has to find a new place to sleep. Frank, one of the workers, sees how upset the new guy is and offers to show him where he can get food and a warm shower. At first, Nada doesn't trust his new friend, but he decides to follow him soon after. The men find something to talk about and bond over along the way. Frank takes the homeless man to a camp and introduces him to friendly people from all over the world who have come to Los Angeles in search of wealth. In this camp, youngsters feel safe helping each other. Gilbert, a local man, instantly assigns George to make the camp cozier. George eats a substantial lunch. Throughout the meal, Frank shares his life story with George. Similar to George, he relocated to another location in order to support his family, who stayed in Detroit. Frank is furious with the local elite for lining their pockets and closing practically every factory in his village, leaving hundreds of people unemployed. If one more plant closes, the man will act. Frank believes that the lower classes must struggle for survival. Therefore, he warns George that he is prepared to compete with him for a spot in the sun. George is more hopeful. He intends to work hard and start his life from scratch. In the evening, Nada is walking around the camp when she sees some locals watching a TV ad for false nails with great interest. At some point, the signal gets cut off, and a broadcast of a man who looks worried comes on. He describes how they all inhabit a universe that was constructed intentionally. According to him, a team of scientists discovered that unidentified aliens send a signal to Earth that induces hypnosis and inhibits critical thought. There are more and more people who are poor, and racism is getting worse. The aliens made people careless about everything except what was good for them, but the people in the town don't pay attention to the weirdo scary message on TV. They just complain of headaches and change the channel during the show. George sees a blind priest repeating the program. Right away, Gilbert runs over to the priest. George can't hear what they're saying, but he thinks they're arguing. Gilbert is in a hurry, so he leads the old man to the church on the campgrounds. George's eyes continue to track the departing guys, and he feels that they are hiding something. The next morning, Nada encounters Gilbert at the camp entrance and decides to inquire about his nighttime church visits. He had to stay overnight at the church's homeless kitchen to organize everything. Gilbert also tells him he sings in the church choir and that rehearsal is starting. The same broadcast with the mysterious man is shown again on TV, and he tells them to stop sending out the signal that makes people sleepy right away. Again, the broadcast gives people terrible headaches, so when the TV goes back to the baseball game, everyone lets out a sigh of relief. Gilbert rushes to the church again because he is worried, and this time George decides to go with him. He can hear the choir singing in the church, so he thinks that going inside won't raise any red flags. In the church, he discovers a miniature chemical laboratory with the cryptic message "They live. We sleep. the man observes a tape recorder that is loudly playing the choir's singing. Its only purpose is to cover up the sounds of the secret meeting going on behind the wall. Gilbert, the man from the TV, was in the next room. Others in the secret group are trying to hack the channel again so that they can play their recording for longer and reach more people. The people in the group want to find as many new members as possible so they can get their ideas out to the public more effectively and efficiently. George retreats and finds a secret vault full with boxes. He shuts the vault and leaves when he encounters the blind priest. George is set free after the priest looks at his face and hands. He figures out that George is the worker and starts talking about the revolution right away, without any hesitation. All of this makes George feel bad, so he runs out of the church. The pastor shouts after the individual that he will eventually return. A police helicopter appears and begins to circle the church, making the meeting attendees anxious. As soon as the helicopter departs, George borrows binoculars from a local adolescent and continuously monitors the building's activity. Gilbert and his minions transport boxes from the building to a vehicle. Frank breaks George's observation. Nada tells Frank what he witnessed at the church, but Frank warns him not to become involved. The car with the boxes in it pulls away from the church at the same time. All day, George looks through the binoculars at the church, but nothing else happens. When it got dark, the cops encircle both the camp and the church. The people are uncertain of their exact guilt, so they follow the proceedings in silence. With the help of bulldozers, the police start tearing down the people's tents and trailers all at once. This causes the people to run away in a panic. George watches in horror as the police destroy the lives of good people in a way that makes him sick. The police catch the priest and the preacher from the TV and put them in a corner. They fight back as hard as they can, but the police beat them until they can't breathe. Everyone who doesn't get out of the camp will die the same way. George is powerless to help those who have already been apprehended by the police, but he does save a terrified teenager. Having narrowly escaped the police, George and the scared teen climb a crumbling church's upper story. They find the survivors sheltering in a room after wandering the corridors. People don't know why they were attacked, and they have to spend the night in a shelter. In the morning, they come out of their hiding place to see what's left of the camp after last night's nightmare. The camp looks like a hurricane hit it, but they locate a working TV with humorous advertising in the middle. George investigates the underground church crypt. During yesterday's raid, the angry writing on the wall next to him was covered up. George finds one box left in the pantry. It is the same as the ones Gilbert quickly took away in the car yesterday. Immediately, a police cruiser passes past the church, forcing George to take cover from law enforcement. After finding a secure location, the man opens the package to discover dozens of pairs of sunglasses. He hides the package in a trash can and takes one pair of glasses. George puts on his spectacles while walking around the city, and everything goes black and white. The whole world, which used to look so familiar, now looks very different. Through the glasses, every billboard, sign, and headline says, obey, marry, have kids, consume, buy, don't think, watch TV, and so on. Instead of seeing pretty pictures in magazines, he sees phrases that try to get people to do what they want. Even people who seemed normal before can now be seen for what they really are, monsters. He removes and reapplies them multiple times to ensure the man in front of him looks like an extraterrestrial. The weird man observes George suspiciously but says nothing. Again, George puts on the glasses and sees the banknotes with "This is your God" written on them. He also finds that every traffic light in the city has a transmitter that sends out a hypnotic voice. It tells you to sleep over and over again. Nada finds out quickly that not everyone is the same. He is amazed to see normal people talk calmly with people who look like alien monsters. It is readily apparent that monsters are the most successful members of society. George pays attention to a politician's speech as he enters the supermarket, while an alien hides behind his face. The man begins to chuckle hysterically upon hearing this news. He cannot resist insulting the woman pushing him, who appears to be a monster through her glasses. He attempts to communicate to the ordinary people around him that they are facing a monster, but merely exposes himself. The lady tells other aliens about a guy who can see their true appearance through her wristwatch walkie-talkie and describes him. The aliens approach after receiving the message. George flees, horrified. He taunts the monstrous woman despite several aliens staring at him. The phony police catch him immediately. George is questioned about where he got the glasses, but he doesn't say. The guards then try to scare him and get him to join them. George, on the other hand, doesn't give up so easily. Immediately, he assaults the police officers, seizes their weapons, and flees. Police cars begin to arrive at the scene almost immediately. Armed, George decides to take refuge in the bank. He discovers that half of the visitors are also aliens. Out of adrenaline, the guy starts shooting at aliens who are hiding as people. One of the aliens calls another police squad, but before George can shoot him, he disappears by magic. He runs out of the bank to escape the aliens and sees a drone pursuing him. George knocks it down and meets a gorgeous girl named Holly in a locked parking lot. He verifies that she is human, then kidnaps her and commands her to take him to her home. This is his sole chance to evade his pursuers, who are rushing towards the bank. George collapses on the floor at Holly's residence, weary, and attempts to justify his behavior. He tells the girl he's sorry for making her feel bad. He tells her that their world is in danger and that evil creatures have taken over and are controlling everyone. Holly turns down George's offer to put on the sunglasses and see for herself. Because she doesn't believe him, Holly tries to sneak past the man when he closes his eyes from being tired, but he watches her every move. After calming down, George asks his hostage what she does. Holly reveals that she is a television assistant director. George wants to break the TV's alien signal. When the guy relaxes, the girl breaks the bottle on his head and pushes him out the window. George is lucky to be alive after falling from the second floor, but he loses his sunglasses. While that is going on, Holly tells the police what happened and has a police squad come to her house. Again compelled to hide from the guards, Nada finds refuge beneath the bridge. The man reaches another neighborhood after dark and spends the night on the street there. He asks Frank for help against the extraterrestrial invaders the next day at the construction site. George just orchestrated a mass shooting, therefore his pal is afraid of him. George attempts to explain to Frank that they were actually aliens disguised as humans, but Frank refuses to listen and urges George to leave. Then, George goes to where he put the box of sunglasses, but none of the trash cans are full. A garbage truck is parked close by. He climbs into the back of the truck and digs through the trash until he finds a few pairs of glasses that didn't break. Frank ends up seeing George's adventures in the trash by accident. Frank pays his pal and claims he can't help. George insists his pal use the spectacles to view the true world. But, Frank refuses and thinks his friend to be insane. George, weary of his friend's mistrust, decides to punch him, and a furious struggle ensues. Finally, Nada kicks his friend to the ground and compels him to wear the glasses. Frank is shocked and horrified to finally believe George. The friends rent a room at a motel nearby, where they talk about what to do next. Frank assumes there are others who see the aliens, and that they must search for them. George relates a childhood story to him. His father routinely abused him while he lived in abject poverty. Class disparity fueled aliens for years. George wants to avenge his damaged life. The friends meet Gilbert, who is also wearing sunglasses, at the motel in the morning. He invites them to a secret meeting that night of people with similar ideas. The companions arrive at the location and encounter seers of various ages. The sunglasses are replaced with new lenses that are safer for the eyes and provide a sharper image. Gilbert describes the Earth-flooded monsters. The extraterrestrial invaders are enticing humanity with wealth and power to serve them. They view the planet as a commercial and transient resource for the third world. All global calamities and climate change are likewise their job. When the aliens utterly exhaust the Earth, they will go on to enslave new planets. Frank is shown the alien watch by a member of the resistance group, and he decides to take it. The protesters haven't been able to figure out the alien device's secret code, which lets them move around freely in space and talk to each other. Gilbert assembles everyone and declares that there are still insufficient men for a large onslaught. Nonetheless, the group is hostile and insists that immediate action is required. Gilbert calms the throng and recommends hacking the signal to wake others up. Holly walks in and gives a hint about where the signal might be. She plays with George's sunglasses nervously and tells him she's sorry for what she did. Their conversation is cut off when the police show up out of nowhere and start shooting at the group. Most of the people in the resistance were killed while they were trying to escape. But George, Frank, and Holly leave the building unharmed. To find Holly, George wants to go to the massacre's core. Frank stops him from implementing his risky plan. He opens an otherworldly portal while trying to figure out the watch's mechanism to intercept alien communication. The police are getting closer and closer to where the friends are hiding, so they have to jump through the portal. They end up in an alien base underground, where they find writings in a language they don't understand. The companions cautiously make their way through a tunnel and encounter an alien roadblock. The radio informs the animals posing as military troops that the mission to remove the terrorist group has been conducted successfully. Frank and George go in the direction of the sounds emanating from the end of the tunnel as the aliens exit to celebrate their triumph. They arrive at a banquet where a man dressed in an expensive suit delivers a speech honoring the alien alliance. He tells the people he has recruited that the aliens will soon take over the whole planet, which will be very good for the top people on Earth. Then he tells the crowd how successful they have been, which makes everyone cheer and applaud. A former resident of the camp who also sided with the invaders approaches the group of pals. He concludes that George and Frank have also been recruited by the aliens, and is startled to see that they are still clothed as poor individuals. The trainees explore the base and visit an extraterrestrial airport with the man. There, human-form aliens visit other planets. They reach the television studio's backstage, where the entire activity is controlled. With the help of the satellite, the signal is sent all over the world, controlling the minds of ordinary people. George gets their tour guide to take them inside the TV studio by making him feel good about himself. The man consents, but the guards will not let them pass without a special pass. The men then decide to employ lethal force and shoot the aliens. Their old friend attempts to stop them and persuade them to conform to the new government. Humans are enslaved by aliens. He encourages them to join the victors and enjoy the aliens' rewards for their loyalty. Despite his protests, the lads won't betray. A soldier enters the room, and the traitor exploits this opportunity to move through space. The companion seize their weapons and break into the studio's main office, where human recruits are working. George asks the workers questions to help him find Holly, but no one knows where she is. But he finds out that the signal that makes people sleepy is on the roof. The friends go straight to the top of the building and run into Holly, who made it out alive. While firing upon the aliens, the gang finally ascends to the uppermost floor. Holly, however, is revealed to be a traitor and shoots Frank in the head before entering the rooftop. George discovers a satellite dish transmitting the alien signal and aims at it. But the female softly approaches him from behind and tells him to surrender, pointing a handgun. He shoots Holly. He ruins the satellite dish. George is promptly fired upon by helicopters. But as he leaves the planet, he gives the aliens the middle finger. George is able to disrupt the transmission, and humanity finally discovers the horrible reality. They now realize that aliens have been hiding among regular people, making TV shows, going to the same places, acting in movies, and even getting together. A Colorado drifter awoke the world. So, what do you think about this recap? Please write on the comment section, assuming you partaking in the recap. Kindly consider like and subscribe into Cinefilm Recap. Gratitude for observing.